Let's go to our man in London, Jacob Sager Weinstein is standing by. I think he's won a couple of awards writing for television. He's graduated to novels. He's the author of a children's thriller called Hyacinth, The Secrets Beneath. That's part of a trilogy. Book two is out. It's called Hyacinth and the Stone Thief, available in bookstores near you. Is it a trilogy? Is there going to be a number three?
There will be a three, but I would say I describe it as more of a fantasy adventure than a thriller. She does stumble onto a conspiracy, but it is a conspiracy involving mud monsters in royal male uniforms rather than like spies and the things that traditionally a thriller would be about.
You're also the author of How Not to Kill Your Baby, which you can get on Amazon.
That's right.
Yeah. Brexit. We keep hearing about it. It's happening. I always thought cooler heads were going to prevail. But Britain is pulling out of the EU. Did the Russians cause this? Back here in the States, we think the Russians played a role in all this.
Нет, товарищ. That is... I can't prove that they did, and I want to emphasize that what I'm about to say is very... There's a lot of smoke, and I suspect there will be fire. I don't know if this is just in the newspapers here today, that one of the major financial backers here in the UK of the Brexit movement met several times with a Russian official under suspicious circumstances. Mm-hmm. And it's the kind of thing where...
Aaron Banks?
Maybe he just
Aaron
like,
Banks?
So I don't want to intimidate your listeners by the sheer amount of research I've done today, but I actually spent 5 minutes walking through my grocery store, glancing at the headlines on my way to buy fruit. So I'm gonna dazzle you with some knowledge.
Just make stuff up. Just yes and yes and.
I don't have to. I'm well informed by the headlines. Okay, I tell you the other fascinating news that I think is really interesting from a policy position, which is Pippa dazzles in new summer swimming suit.
Now Pippa would be the sister of the Duchess of Cambridge.
Yes, this is Pippa Middleton, who you may not care about the if you don't care about the royals, as is my feeling, then she is your not care about in law.
Does she get invited to Buckingham Palace?
Oh, I'm sure she must. I mean, we invite my sister in law to our flat all the time. And you know the royals are just like us.
Now with the Duchess of Sussex, I'm talking about Meghan Markle.
Yes, of course. She's just Meghan to me. When she comes over, we're very casual. Mm-hmm.
Have you thought of writing a screenplay about the possibilities of who could end up being queen or king of Great Britain?
You know, now that you mention it, you could make a great movie where, like, everybody gets, say, electrocuted by in the process of being photographed, and an American bumpkin named Ralph. Oh, they've done it, damn it. Ah.
That was John Goodman.
Yes, exactly.
What about a gay king having a gay wedding?
You know, I would not be... I will say this. I will make this bold prediction. We will certainly have a gay prime minister before we have a gay president. We may even have a gay king or queen before America has a gay president. And I'm not happy about that as an American, but as a British person, I intend to lord that over.
Now,
I should mention I'm a joint citizen, so I can sort of claim allegiance to whichever country gives me the conversational advantage in that moment.
Is Great Britain, the stereotype is that Great Britain is more understanding. The stereotype is it's a gay country. Is it a gay country? In America, we like to say... Now, is that because Americans who are gay put on a British affect? Or is it a gay country?
So this is very impressive. I've been on your podcast many times, and I believe the last 30 seconds hold the record for the most ways I can get in deep trouble in a single conversation. I commend you, Mr. Feldman. You have outdone
everybody.
Yourself.
There's so many landmines now. Everybody's so afraid. I was on Facebook over the weekend saying, let's not romanticize Anthony Bourdain's suicide. You know, whatever happened to suicide is not the option. You know, it's kind of bad to commit suicide. We're a little too understanding of it. Boy, did
you, maybe you've been seeing different Facebook posts than I have. I haven't seen anybody saying that, like, applauding Bourdain for his suicide. I've seen a lot of people applauding Bourdain for his life and telling people who may be suffering depression that they can reach out and get help. Do you see that as a sign of weakness? Because that is not at all how I see
think
that.
There's been a tendency to romanticize him and be very forgiving of his pain, as opposed to saying there's a little personal responsibility here. You can't commit suicide. And it just seems to be presented as an option now, which might contribute to the contagion.
Okay, so I think, although you and I disagree on many things, I think something you and I have in common is we both believe in science. That if somebody has spent their life studying something and applying the scientific method to it, I'm inclined to assume they know more about it
yes.
than I do. And I'm not a psychiatrist or a psychologist, but my understanding is that the contemporary medical thinking is that suicide and depression are specific mental conditions. They're not just being weak. They're not just doing the wrong thing. It's a specific mental condition. There are specific therapies that can treat it depending on the specific source of it. And again, I'm not a psychiatrist, but I think just telling people you're a bad person if you do this has not been shown to be a clinically effective.
I'm not saying you're a bad person for committing suicide. I'm saying you can't do it. It's unacceptable.
Yeah, but again, I don't think that's what's – I don't think that stops.
Right, but I
think
but,
that's –
But I think that there's a little under the guise of compassion and this heart pouring that goes out for Anthony Bourdain, there's some accountability that has to be laid out in front of him. You can't commit suicide. It's just not acceptable. And people need to keep saying that. There's a little too much understanding of it. I worry about that. That's all.
When I hear people really desperate or really passionate about taking an option off the table, about it's when it's really important for people, when it's really important for an evangelical to say we can't have gay marriage. People, it's not an option. People should not have gay sex, because if we let that, then everybody would. I hear an echo of that in what you're saying. And I'm wondering, and again, tell me, you don't have to answer this, but is this something you've struggled with, that you sometimes felt?
No, I've struggled with like other people not committing suicide. I've been trying to No, I think there are some basic rules of the road. You can't molest kids. If you have an urge to molest your child or somebody else's child, and I know it can't be cured. They've said that about child molestation. You can't cure a pedophile. You have to suppress that urge. Those are the rules of the road. If you're suicidal, if there's so much pain in your brain, you can't commit suicide. You just can't.
So I guess, in a... So I guess I feel like I agree with every stone in your quarry, but I'm not sure I'm quite willing to move into the castle you're building yet. And what I mean is that I absolutely agree with you. Certainly suicide should not be an option. And I saw your Facebook post and you talked about the responsibilities Anthony Bourdain had to his family. And I get where you're coming from. But I guess my question is, if your goal is to stop suicide, does saying what you're saying help? Does applying...
Yes.
Guilt
yes.
to somebody, even if it's a theoretical.
Yes.
Well, here's, you know, again, I'm not an expert. I will tell you my own very limited experience is when I was a teenager, I never tried to commit suicide. I never got to the point of having a plan, but there were times where I contemplated it. And in my case, I don't think there was anything specific. I was a very lucky, privileged kid. I think it's just sort of the usual emotional turmoil of adolescence. But, and, maybe because I had sort of a mild case of whatever that is, I was able to think about the effect that it would have on my family, and I was able to consider that. And that was probably one of the things that in my case did stop
okay.
me from doing it. But I will also tell you that I know that people that I had a mild case of it. When I've read firsthand accounts of people who have been much closer than I ever was, it's it's not, there's not that ability to think things through in the way you're suggesting people should. It's like, you know, the analogy people always use is that if you have a broken leg, you can't just tell somebody, just get better, stop being broken. But the issue is that you're not thinking with your leg. The broken part of you is not the part that's analyzing how to get better. And when you have a mental issue, you're trying to solve the problem with the limb that is suffering.
I'm not vilifying anybody who commits suicide.
Right.
But I don't think it should be presented as an understanding option to people. I think part of the contagion that takes place, especially among teenagers in high schools, because once one kid kills himself, it's like the hula hoop. The idea of killing yourself in France, there's something romantic about that. The idea of killing yourself is an act of anger. And I don't understand suicide. I understand the pain, the mental pain that could cause somebody to see no options. And it's tragic and sad. When we talk of suicide as an option, it presents itself to people who are in a lot of pain. I just think you have to have, it's like child molestation. You have to say, you can't do it. Period. That I think you have to say that, don't you? Doesn't the Bible say no suicide?
Well, yeah, but the Bible also says no shrimp.
No shrimp.
So, you know, that shellfish. Surely you know this, the two things that the Bible describes as an abomination in the eyes of the Lord are homosexuality and shellfish. So I've always wanted to sort of like stand outside some right winger's house and protest the fact that he's teaching children about shrimp and lobsters and say that we should not expose our children to this decadent shellfish lifestyle.
But that's Leviticus, but, right? I mean,
but
nothing in the New Testament, nothing in the Talmud, right, about homosexuality. Just agree with me. Nobody reads this stuff. Trust me.
Yes. Well, I think Mr. Feldman and Mr. Sager Weinstein are in agreement on what Jesus says about homosexuality. Nope. Paul says there's some brief things about men lying with men, but Jesus himself never said anything. And in any case, you're baiting
me.
No,
I'm not. Did Paul really say that about men lying with men?
I think so. And again, unfortunately, there was nothing about Paul's prescriptions on homosexuality on the headlines of the newspapers I walked by this morning. So I haven't even done my 30 seconds of research. But if I remember my Episcopal school education of 30 years ago, I believe there is one or two references to men should not lie with men. But that's about as much as the New Testament says. And it's not from Jesus himself. It is from one of his disciples.
Well, I guess what I'm trying to say is if you're listening and you're in a lot of pain, and if you're listening, you probably are in a lot of pain. Suicide's not an option. I need all the listeners. I can't lose any listeners.
So I would say if you're listening, I would certainly agree that suicide is not an option, but I would say that the step beyond it is not just to say don't do it, it's to reach out and get help. And if you have friends, if there's suicide hotline numbers, there's a step beyond don't do it, and that is get help.
Okay. All right. So back to Brexit.
Yes.
This is going to...
Yes, speaking of self-harm.
Are you for Brexit or against it?
I am strongly for Brexit because I think it's time we got rid of all those foreigners like me who are coming to this country and dragging it to happen. No, I am against Brexit. I am baffled by it. You said earlier in the conversation that you're amazed that it seems like it's going to happen, that you thought cooler heads would prevail. There is still the chance that it will. There's a bill that Parliament is currently debating, and as I understand it, it is not pro or against Brexit. It assumes that Brexit will happen, and it is an effort to sort of harmonize, to figure out how you fill the hole in British laws when EU laws no longer apply. So the House of Commons sent it to the House of Lords, who added a bunch of amendments to it, which are just you know, crazy things saying Parliament should actually get a vote in the final say. And then they sent it back. It's also things about having to do with sort of immigrants' rights and other things. Now, Commons over the next 2 days is going to be voting on how to proceed with this newly amended bill. The Tories are pretty upset that the Lords have amended it as much as they have. Basically, they would say that the House of Lords does not have that the House of Lords isn't supposed to stop the country from shooting itself in the foot. They should just like help us.
What happened? Yeah, hello, are you alive?
I am alive. Apparently, I just think for a minute I visited this interview, but I seem to be back.
Okay, good.
I was saying, so Theresa May is accusing the House of Lords.
Theresa May is the Prime Minister.
The bounds. Yes, she is okay. The Prime Minister, she's the perfect person to lead Brexit because she was opposed to it up to the moment it happened, and then suddenly she was for it. And even though it's going to ruin the country, she's promised to make a success of it. So I think she is the ideal leader for these times.
Okay. Not to sound Trumpian, maybe all this stuff is just gobbledygook. The EU, maybe you don't need the European Parliament. And maybe we're just convinced that it's a populist move to pull out and it's silly and stupid and dangerous. We don't understand any of this stuff. Including the people in charge.
I feel like I'm listening to the next Prime Minister of Great Britain.
I don't know. We accept things because we're told that it's the right way to think. But we don't really understand how this stuff works.
I'm really not joking. I say that was more or less the pro-Brexit campaign platform. Was there's an actual quote which was, I think the British people are sick of hearing from experts.
Well,
and it's this idea that has infected the United States as well, that my opinion is as good as your lifetime of research into the facts.
Okay, crime in Great Britain,
yes.
From what I understand, you guys don't have guns. A couple of your cops do. About 6,000 cops have guns in all of Great Britain. You had a crime rate that was so low, you started firing cops, and now they're gangs and stabbings and even shootings. And I read somewhere that London's murder rate is actually higher this year than New York's.
It has been higher in certain months, which is shocking to me. You know, I think you said it when you said that we started getting rid of cops, that there has been, under the Tories, there has been this real austerity push over the past couple of years. And actually, it sort of ties into the argument you were making before, that, look, who knows if having police officers in the street actually prevents crime? Let's find out. Let's get rid of a lot of them and see what happens. And this is the consequence. And I still feel because there's strict gun control law here, I still feel vastly safer walking down the streets of London than I do many places in the world. But it is shocking to me, and it's a real condemnation of austerity that London has, even if only temporarily, caught up to New York.
Do you feel bullied on the street?
No, I've never had a problem. I feel totally safe walking down the street. And maybe I'm naive, but I just haven't had a problem.
There was a BBC presenter who was mugged. People are being mugged all the time now. It seems to me that the headlines in Great Britain are about the crime rate, that it's gone up, and that there are these stabbings. I've advocated for firing more and more police officers and hiring more teachers in America, because the crime rate has gone down.
I want to propose a compromise here, which is, what if you fire the police officers and you also fire teachers?
Now you're talking.
This is the Tory policy. Yes. This is so. Yeah. I mean, there has been, you know, Tony Blair's slogan many years ago was tough on crime, tough on the causes of crime, and I think the Tories have taken the spirit of that on and sort of soft on crime, soft on the causes of crime. that they're cutting back. You know, there's been cuts in school libraries. There's been cuts all around. So I think it's not just a short-term problem. I do think we'll be seeing the consequences of this for years to come.
Well, it's an interesting experiment to see what happens when you get rid of cops. You're saying crime goes up. I happen to think that the austerity in Great Britain is causing lots of problems among the people, like drug use is up.
That was not mentioned in the headline about Pippa's new bathing suit, so I'll have to take your word for
that. Well, in Great Britain, cocaine is an epidemic. Did you know that?
I did not know
that. The highest proportion of cocaine users in Europe is in Britain. Now, you have kids. 4% of children in Great Britain have taken cocaine. Taken it.
Yeah, that's shocking to me. What age are the children in that?
18 to 34. At my age, I call them kids.
No, and I think that's a symptom. I do think that there is, I would, that's just, I think, sort of a symptom of the overall, I guess, the overall lack of trust in society and economic anxiety. Yeah.
How do you treat yourself in London? I wish I were there right now.
Well, that's why I treat myself in London. You're not here. It's I felt no free zone. No, I would love to have you here. The way I treat myself, honestly, is just walking through the city. I find this just such an amazing city to walk through. It's so walkable that if I get a chance, I would walk from my house in northwest London into the center of the town, which would be like an hour and a half, 2 hours. You walk over Primrose Hill and have a gorgeous view of the city. You walk into the city. It's a great walk.
And what are you going to eat? I know you're a foodie.
So this is a difficult question because my two favorite gelato places in London are both sort of on the walk I would take into the center of town. So I would either eat gelato or gelato. And if you could follow up with me next time, I will, you know, but it's actually literally when I go into these places, they now know me, they recognize me, they smile at me. So basically after 15 years living in London, I finally have a local.
Has it been 15 years?
It's been 15 years. We moved here for a 2-year stay in 2002, and we are still here.
Wow. Well, Jacob Sager Weinstein is the author of Hyacinth, The Secrets Beneath. His new book is Hyacinth and the Stone Thief. It's a children's, I call it like a thriller, but how did you want to describe it?
Yes, you call it that because you have not read it, but that's...
Well, I'm not a child.
Well, oh, fair enough. I describe it as a fast-paced fantasy. Set in London.
And you're also the author of How Not to Kill Your Baby. You've been coming to us today from London, England. So you claim. Thank you.
Comrade, I do not know what you mean.
Stay on the line for 1 second.
All right.